Before I begin my talk, I would like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the world and their connections to the land, seas, and communities across our planet. I pay my respects to elders past and present, and extend that respect to all First Nations and Indigenous peoples globally. Imagine opening up your front door to a world where the air is thick with smoke, the sky is a terrifying shade of red, and the heat so intense it felt like the very ground was on fire. This is not a scene from a dystopian movie. This was the reality for thousands of Australians on Saturday, the 7th of February, 2009. This day would be etched in Australian history as Black Saturday. This was also a time where over 170 people died due to multiple bushfires, specifically in the state of Victoria, where I was living at the time. The state had endured temperatures of well above 40 degrees Celsius for a few days, so the area was hot, dry, and a tinderbox waiting to ignite. Then the fire started. Fires which were as high as a 30-story building, with a radiant heat so intense it could be felt up to 3 football fields before the fire. Of the people that died on Black Saturday, many were children. And as a parent and as a mother, with my then toddler and newborn baby in my arms, I wept and wept for those families. Fast forward to 2014, and I was volunteering building houses in rural Cambodia. When I was there, I heard heartbreaking stories about the intense typhoon season, which were getting stronger and stronger each year, where walls of water would come down and wash away their traditional thatched houses, sometimes with their children still inside, being washed away. And as a parent and as a mother, with my now 2 young boys at home, I wept and wept for those families. Now, there are reasons why the fire started on Black Saturday and for the increase in intensity and severity of the typhoons in Southeast Asia. But a common reason to both is climate change. The effects of climate change, such as increased fires, floods, and droughts, are particularly devastating. Not only do they destroy lives and livelihoods, but also because it increases inequality amongst people. And it's this concept of increasing inequality which also really worries me. When I was a child, we traveled a lot for my father's work, and we stayed for a period of time in the Philippines. And I have a clear memory of walking down the streets of Manila, holding my mother's hand, my father and his best friend Dennis walking just ahead of us. And then I saw Dennis bend down and scoop up this boy, who must have been about 12 years old, who was so skinny and malnourished he had simply collapsed on the pavement. Dennis had walked with him for a while, not knowing what to do. My little child brain couldn't understand what I was seeing. Why some children like me were happy, healthy, well-fed, and safe, while others were not. This was the first moment that I was introduced to inequality and the gross unfairness of it. The thing is, climate change will increase inequality amongst the most vulnerable in our society. The poor, the elderly, women, and children. According to NASA, greenhouse gas emissions, of which the majority is carbon dioxide, has been rising since the Industrial Revolution through the burning of fossil fuels such as coal, oil, and gas. Now, we do need carbon dioxide on this planet for us to live. The issue is we now have far too much of it, and it's acting like a form of pollution for us. But how does this rising level of carbon emissions actually affect the Earth? Well, today I have a live demonstration with a model Earth. If you could please come on stage. When we continue to release more carbon emissions into the atmosphere, it has the effect of warming up our planet, which is like adding layers of coats on the Earth. So far, the Earth has warmed up 1.1 degrees Celsius. And as you can see, even our own model Earth here is looking all hot and bothered. Thank you. But what can we do? Well, the very first thing we need to do is we need to reduce the amount of carbon emissions that we are releasing. The good news is there are solutions out there as governments, as companies, and as individuals to take. There are also many TED Talks on these solutions, and I encourage you to look at them all. But in addition to reducing the amount of carbon emissions that we release, we need to remove the excess carbon dioxide that's in the atmosphere. That is, we need to start taking the coats off the Earth. The great news is there are solutions out there for us to do this. And these solutions are either man-made or natural. And today, I'm going to talk about one type of natural solution. And I have brought a sample size of this solution with me today. Trees. Well, specifically, forests. Trees absorb the carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, and they store it in their leaves, branches, trunks, and roots. They then release oxygen and water vapor back into the atmosphere, contributing to air quality. And one of the largest forests on the Earth is the Amazon rainforest. In the early 2000s, my husband and I went backpacking deep in the Amazon jungle in Brazil. There we are, looking all young and fresh-faced. During the day, we got to walk deep in the jungle. And I remember the trees so tall, they were like giants standing next to me, of hearing the strange sounds of the animals hidden deep in the forest. And the air so thick with mist, felt like you were walking through clouds. It was truly magical. Now, the Amazon is on fire and a source of carbon emissions. An area the size of Italy has already burned in Brazil. And much of these fires are deliberate. They are to clear the lands for farming, logging, and mining. This destruction of nature not only contributes to climate change, but also contributes to the loss of animals, plants, and insects because they call these places home. After we left the Philippines as a child, we moved to the Mediterranean island of Malta. And every Saturday, my father and I would jump off the pier and go snorkeling in the crystal clear blue waters. And again, as a child, I remember seeing schools and schools of brightly colored fish kind of shimmering all around me, creating a living rainbow. It was in this moment where I first fell in love with nature, especially the sea. Now, the Mediterranean is one of the most overfished regions in the world, mainly due to bottom trawling fishing, which casts out these wide nets and scoops everything in its path. Also, the amount of plastics is a problem. And remember, what ends up in the waters ends up in us. According to scientists, we are currently living through the sixth mass extinction of life on Earth. The last mass extinction was 65 million years ago, which wiped out the dinosaurs. However, unlike previous extinction events, which were caused by natural occurrences. This one that we're living through right now is caused by us, by how we use the earth and climate change. We therefore need to solve for both climate change and nature loss, which are intertwined anyway. But how do we do this? Well, again, according to scientists, it is the protection of our lands, oceans, and seas, which is crucial for nature's survival. Protected areas on Earth can offer significant benefits for nature, indigenous peoples, and the local community. And one example I'd like to share with you today is of Hervey Bay in Queensland, Australia. Up until the 1960s, Hervey Bay used to be a whaling station where thousands upon thousands upon thousands of southern humpback whales were slaughtered for their oil. So much so that only 450 were left in the wild. The Australian government then shut down the whaling station and made Hervey Bay a protected area. Now there are 40,000 humpback whales in the area, and Hervey Bay is a global tourism hotspot where you can go, as I recently did, to catch a boat and see these majestic creatures. So protected areas do work. However, only about 15% of our global lands is protected, and only 7% of the oceans and seas is protected. This small level of protection is simply not enough to prevent mass extinction. It's all a bit doom and gloom, isn't it? But I'm here to tell you that there is hope. Recently, the governments around the world also realized the importance of nature and committed to urgent actions to protect it. It is called the Global Biodiversity Framework. This framework has a set of targets for nature, including a 30% conservation target of the lands and seas by 2030. So there is hope, but hope requires action. Actions from the politicians that we elect, actions from the companies that we buy from, and actions taken by us as individuals. Before I go today, I want to leave you with one number, 2000. We have approximately 2,000 days until the year 2030. That's 2,000 days to increase land protection from 15% to 30%. That's 2,000 days to increase ocean and seas protection from 7% to 30%. It's not a lot of time. But what can we as individuals do? Now remember, there is hope, but hope requires action. And there's three action steps that we can all take. Contact your local politician. Second, switch the companies that you buy from. And thirdly, support a conservation or protection organization. Now, firstly, I want you to think about your local politician. I want you to ask him or her what they are doing to increase the protections of the land, seas, and oceans where you live to 30%. Challenge them to create a new national park, either on land or on sea or both. And here in Cyprus, let's continue to protect the Akamas National Park from any unnecessary development. Secondly, think about the companies that you buy from. Do you know what their credentials are on nature and climate? If it's not good enough, switch. Switch to companies that demonstrate a positive impact to nature and climate. Remember, every time you buy a product or service from a company, you are supporting their activities. So choose wisely. And thirdly, tell me about a local or global conservation or protection organization that you are aware of, that you are going to join, volunteer, and support. Please, let's share your stories. Use your social medias on these three topics because we need to inspire the world and encourage others. Finally, I want you to consider this. What will be your personal impact over the next 2,000 days? What is the legacy that you will leave behind for your family? Because as a parent and as a mother, our family's futures depend on the action that we all take in the next 2,000 days. Thank you.